Namaskar, Anyong Hasanika. This is Sonu Trivedi, Director of the Swami Vivekanand Cultural Center at Embassy of India in Seoul, welcoming you all to the 130th birth anniversary celebrations of the architect of Indian Constitution and one of the legendary figures among the makers of modern India, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, which is a part of our special lecture series under India at 75 celebrations. I'm extremely delighted to have amongst us Dr. Narinder Jadhav, an expert on Dr. B.R. Ambedkar's ideas and philosophy, along with the presence of Her Excellency Shri Priya Ranganathan, Ambassador of India to Republic of Korea. We are also privileged today to have partnered with Department of Political Science of Zakir Hussain Delhi College, University of Delhi, in organizing this lecture, and I welcome all the students and faculty members who have joined us here today. Friends, let me begin with a brief introduction of Babasaheb Bhimrao Ambedkar. A pioneering social reformer, jurist, economist, author, orator, scholar of comparative religions, and thinker, Dr. Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar, the principal architect of Indian Constitution and independent India's first law minister, was a multifaceted personality who remapped the frontiers of human achievement by his sheer tenacity, perseverance, and the will to excel against all odds. Born on 14th April 1891 to parents Ramji Maloji Sakpal and Bhimabai Murbatkar Sakpal at Mau in Madhya Pradesh, Dr. Ambedkar came from a humble beginning, but he went on to become one of India's greatest leaders. Born into the Mahar caste, which was scorned as the untouchables by the upper castes of the time, Babasaheb did not allow the limitations of his background to come in the way of acquiring first-rate education and pushing the bar for academic excellence. After completing his early years of education from Elphinstone College in Mumbai, he earned a law degree from Lincoln's Inn and doctorates from Columbia University in the United States and the London School of Economics, carving a place of eminence as a scholar extraordinaire for his research in law, economics, and political science. His early career saw him donning many hats as an economist, professor, and lawyer. In the next stage, he emerged as a national leader with a pan-India vision of modernity underpinned by the ideals of social justice and equality. As India's freedom movement gained traction, he harnessed his formidable intellectual energies to script an anthem of an inclusive India and strove tirelessly for political rights and social freedom for Dalits and the marginalized groups. The constitution drafted under Dr. Ambedkar's leadership abolished untouchability and outlawed all forms of discrimination. An ardent proponent of the rights of women, minorities, and socially underprivileged, he argued eloquently and won the Constituent Assembly's support for introducing a system of reservations of job in the civil services, schools and colleges for members of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. This was later reflected in the policies of affirmative action adopted in the Indian government, by the Indian government. An erudite economist and an institution builder, Dr. Ambedkar authored many scholarly treatises on economics and was the driving force behind establishment of the Finance Commission of India. His ideas also laid the foundation for setting up of India's central bank, the Reserve Bank of India. While Dr. Ambedkar's achievements were manifold and straddled a wide spectrum, his inner life was richer and marked by spiritual vitality. He had declared his decision to renounce Hinduism in 1936 in his annihilation of caste speech and later converted to Buddhism in 1956. Ambedkar spent these two decades from 1930s to 50s to study other prominent religions and chose one he found to be the best among all. His quest for morally sound religion that looked at the welfare of every human being took him to Buddhism. Shortly after his conversion to Buddhism, he died in his sleep on 6th December 1956 at his home in Delhi while working on his book titled The Buddha and His Dhamma, which was published posthumously. Let me not further dwell upon the legacy of Dr. Ambedkar, as we already have a very eminent speaker, Dr. Narinder Jadhav, to share his views on Dr. Ambedkar's multifaceted contribution to modern India. Without much ado, Let me now call upon Her Excellency Shri Priya Ranganathan, Ambassador of India to Republic of Korea, for welcome remarks. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Sonu. Namaskar, sir. Such a pleasure to have you in our platform today. Friends, students, researchers, members of the academic fraternity, the media people from India and from Korea who are joining us for this very, very interesting and very, very important conversation that we are having today. It is a happy day. It is a day when we celebrate the birth anniversary, the 130th birth anniversary of one of the architects of modern India, Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. And it is an opportunity for us not only to remember him, but to remember the principles that he stood by and what he has left behind for us. Sonu has mentioned at great length many of the elements of the work that he did. I will also echo her a little bit in some of what I will say. I think it would be fair to say that Dr. Ambedkar is rightly so regarded as the architect of the Indian Constitution. It was he, in his capacity of the chairman of the drafting committee of the Constitution as part of the Constituent Assembly, who in a way shaped and created the principles that underlie the Republic of India. It was he who in a way gave the kind of pluralistic, inclusive, and just constitution that we have as a nation been able to count upon and which animates the Indian Republic till today. It was he who placed the highest emphasis on equal rights and social justice to all. And it is these ideals of social justice and inclusive development that have formed the bedrock of the Indian Republic. And it was for these contributions that the government of India had honored him with the highest civilian honor that India has to offer, that is the Bharat Ratna, way back in 1990. I think all those who are here who are Indians would be very familiar with this, but for the benefit of our Korean friends, I would just like to mention some elements of the Indian Constitution that I think have really made us what we are today. It is a remarkable document in itself. It is, as all constitutions of all democratic nations, it is the Supreme Court that outlines the principles, the values, the vision, and the aspirations of the Indian people. It lies at the heart of the democracy that we have nurtured and which has nurtured the Indian nation right from the time that it came into force back in January 1950. I think the Indian tradition of inclusiveness finds full expression in this constitution. And many of the features of this constitution were really given concrete shape by Dr. Ambedkar. He gave us truly a constitution that is of the people, by the people, for the people. And we have, over the decades, found that this constitution has stood the test of time. It has allowed itself to be shaped in keeping with the changing needs of our nation, with the changing demands of our people, while retaining intact what we call the basic structure of the constitution, which has remained unaltered over all these decades that we have not only survived but have flourished as a nation. Today, as we celebrate the 130th birth anniversary of Dr. Ambedkar with respect and with affection, we can say with pride that he remains our guide and our inspiration as we seek to make ourselves even more progressive, make ourselves even more equal, and create a more just and more equitable society for ourselves. Friends, as a woman myself, I can say that I am deeply grateful to Dr. Ambedkar for some of the principles that he made part of our constitution and which have really made it possible for me to be standing here talking to you today as the Indian ambassador. And these are the two principles, one of universal adult suffrage, and the second was of equality of status and of opportunity to all citizens, regardless of who you are, where you come from, what you are, what gender you are. It does not matter. As long as you are an Indian national, you have, as an Indian citizen, you have the same rights, the same responsibilities, and the same privileges. For this, I think we must thank leaders like Dr. Ambedkar, who held the view, and I quote, I measure the progress of a community by the degree of progress which women have achieved. And I think it is remarkable that a person at that time, we're talking about 1940s, 1950s India, which is not the world of the 2020s, it is not the world of the 21st century. It was by no means taken for granted that women would have the same access to opportunities, the same access to education, the same access to economic rights as the men. And I think he understood that systematically women had been denied such access to opportunities over the decades, over the centuries of India's colonization, and needed active encouragement and active empowerment. He therefore championed the cause of women just as he championed the cause of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes and other backward sections of our society. He discussed the problems of Indian women and sought for their solutions, not only in his capacity as the chairman of the drafting committee of the Constitution, but also in his role in the Bombay Legislative Council, in the Viceroy's Assembly, and so on. Also, as the first, as Sonu has pointed out, as the first law minister of independent India, he held the needs of women as well as other backward sections of society very much in the forefront. I think for all these reasons and more, we must remember the legacy that this great man has left behind for us and hold true to these principles and the vision that he had of creating an India which was inclusive, which was just, and where anybody who had the right attitude and who had the right values would have the opportunity to not only benefit from our country, but also contribute to our country. And I think we are very, very privileged to be able to listen today Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir, who has not only as a member of parliament, but as a very eminent academic and an expert on Dr. Ambedkar. We are looking forward to hearing what you have to say, sir. And I think that the conversation that we have today will be something that we will remember for a long time to come. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you all for your attention. And I'm hugely looking forward to the hour ahead. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am, for your welcome remarks. And also sharing the contribution of Dr. Ambedkar, the efforts that he made for women's empowerment, and also how he was a main contributor towards building up a just and inclusive India. We now would screen a short documentary on Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, which has been shared by Rajya Sabha TV.
Legend has it that a spiritual ancestor blessed Ramji and his wife Bhima that they will bear a son who will brighten the dark horizon of his people. The son, Bhimrao, was thus born on 14th April 1891 in the military colony of Mhau in Madhya Pradesh, his father being a Subedar Major in the Indian Army. It is not difficult to imagine how the young Ambedkar's sensitive mind reacted to the treatment the untouchables were given. In school, the teachers were kind and compassionate. One of the Brahmin teachers was fond of young Bhim and was so impressed by his intellect that he lent his own name to the young student. And thus, Bhimrao Ambedkar became Bhimrao Ambedkar. After graduation, he served the progressive-minded Maharaja of Baroda, Sayaji Rao Gaikwad, who provided Ambedkar with a scholarship to go abroad. Before he set sail, Ambedkar lost his father. Columbia University, New York. In 1915, Ambedkar was awarded a master's degree for his thesis, Ancient Indian Commerce. Ambedkar returned home in April 1923 before the degree of Doctor of Science was awarded to him. A great reception awaited the young man. From then on, while practicing law in the Bombay High Court, he plunged headlong into his life's mission to uplift the untouchables, to educate them. To achieve these goals, his first organizational attempt was the establishment of the Bahishkrita Hitkarani Sabha. In 1926, he was nominated by the governor to the Bombay Legislative Council. As a conscientious legislator, Ambedkar applied his erudition and legal knowledge to champion the causes of the lowly and the poor. The Mahar Vatan Bill, seeking to free the untouchables from village bondage, women's emancipation, education of the poor, prohibition. No subject which touched the lives of the downtrodden and the weaker sections escaped Dr. Ambedkar's scrutiny. Dr. Ambedkar was invited to the Roundtable Conference in London in September 1930 as a representative of the depressed classes. The objective of the conference, held at the historic St. James Palace, was to frame a constitution for India by taking into account the views of various sections of people. In July 1942, Dr. Ambedkar was invited to join the Viceroy's Executive Council as a Labour member. Dr. Ambedkar was elected to the Constituent Assembly of India in October 1946. His outstanding moment came when he was elected and made chairman of the committee to draft the constitution. August 15, 1947, India met her destiny and became a free nation in the world. Dr. Ambedkar, besides becoming the law minister in the interim government of Free India, was ordained to become the principal architect of the Constitution of India. The happiest person was Mahatma Gandhi. "It was a proud moment for India," he told Ambedkar himself, "that the former downtrodden had become the lawmaker of Free India." Ambedkar's extensive knowledge of world history, his profound commitment to the universal democratic principles, and concern for safeguarding the human and political rights of the minorities went into the monumental work of drafting the document. His reply in the House on the prolonged discussion of the draft is considered among the remarkable speeches in India's parliamentary history. When the Constituent Assembly, in the name of the people of India, adopted the constitution with its 395 articles and 8 schedules on November 26, 1949, no less than Dr. Rajendra Prasad, President of the Constituent Assembly, and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Prime Minister of the interim government, paid glowing tributes to Dr. Ambedkar, the great son of India, who gave self-respect and political rights to the millions of untouchables of India.
Well, friends, that was a short documentary on Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. We now move to our special guest for today's lecture, Dr. Narinder Jadhav, who is a member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha, nominated by the President of India. Professionally, Dr. Jadhav is an economist, educationist, academic, administrator, and author in English, Marathi, and Hindi. As an independent MP, Dr. Jadhav has carved out a distinct place for himself through his studious interventions in the House and while serving on various standing committees. Holding a PhD in economics from Indiana University, United States, Dr. Jadhav has had an outstanding professional career spanning over 4 decades in public service. Some of the distinguished positions held by him with distinction include member of the Planning Commission, Vice Chancellor of Savitribai Phule Pune University, advisor at International Monetary Fund, and Chief Economist at Reserve Bank of India. Having worked as a distinguished professor at Council for Social Development, New Delhi, Dr. Jadhav is currently a visiting professor at Ashoka University and in Indian School of Business. Dr. Jadhav is a prolific writer. He has written and edited 41 books, which includes 21 in English, 13 in Marathi, and 7 in Hindi, besides 31 official reports on various public policy issues. His family biography in English, titled Untouchables, is an international bestseller, which was translated into 15 languages. And friends, let me tell you that the Korean edition is one of the bestsellers and is popular among youth as well as all Koreans. The Marathi original of his biography, Amcha Baapan Ami, has created history with unprecedented 201 editions. Its Punjabi version received Sahitya Akademi Award. A celebrated public figure, Dr. Jadhav is recipient of 70 national and international awards for his contribution to the fields of economics, education, and literature. These include 4 honorary D.Litt degrees and the title of Commander of the Order of Academic Palms by the Government of France. Let us hear, Dr. Jadhav, to your views on Dr. Ambedkar, along with his lifelong dedication to awaken the social conscience of modern India. It is a personal pleasure and delight to welcome you once again, sir, and we look forward to your insights. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sonu, for a very generous introduction. Her Excellency Supriya Ranganathan, Ambassador of India to Republic of Korea, Dr. Sonu Trivedi, Mrs. Savita Singh, researchers, scholars, students, ladies and gentlemen. At the very outset, my humble tribute to the ever-inspiring memory of Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar on the occasion of his 130th birth anniversary. Well, friends, it is indeed a great pleasure as well as an honor to be the chief guest at the first ever, I believe, Ambedkar Jayanti celebrations organized by the Indian Embassy in South Korea in collaboration with Zakir Hussain Delhi College and under the umbrella, the broader umbrella of the ongoing India at 75 program. So I'm delighted to be here. The Korean Republic is really very close to my heart. My best-selling family autobiography, Untouchables, and Sonuji mentioned that, which has been translated into 15 languages, Indian and foreign, you know, was published in Korea in 2007 by Jim Young, and it has sold larger number of copies in Korea than in any other country of the world. I still carry fond memories of my visit to Seoul in 2007 and again in 2013. That was organized by my dear friend, Mr. Byung Sing Oh, the then Consul General of Korea in Mumbai. And last month, we have been in touch, and last month, he drew a wonderful portrait of mine and has sent it to me. I'm really touched by this generosity and the warmth and affection that I have got when I came to Korea twice in the past has been very, truly, very, very gratifying. And I will carry the fond memories with me for times to come. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to take this opportunity today to share some thoughts on Dr. Ambedkar's multifaceted contribution to modern India. The background is already laid by Her Excellency Ambassador Supriya Ji and Dr. Sonu, and added to that was the Rajya Sabha TV film, the short documentary on Dr. Ambedkar. What I want to do is to, I've been told that I should speak for 30 minutes. I started at 12:24. I will speak for about 30 minutes and it would be followed by an live interaction session, Q&A for about 30 minutes. That is what I've been told. Dr. Ambedkar was an intellectual colossus and a very multifaceted genius. There are at least 12 different dimensions to his personality that we could talk about. And these include, to my mind, first one is a knowledge seeker par excellence. Second, economist extraordinaire. Third, outstanding economic administrator. Fourth is social reformer and emancipator of the downtrodden. Fifth, educationist with a social conscience. Sixth, champion of annihilation of caste. 7, anthropologist with a difference. 8, first law minister of independent India. 9, epoch-making statesman. 10, the principal architect of the Indian constitution. 11th, critique of linguistic reorganization of states. And you will see how important it is. And 12th, final one is modern day champion of Buddhism. We are going to cover all of these in a rapid fire. As you have seen, to look at the first aspect of his dimension of personality, knowledge seeker par excellence, Dr. Ambedkar had his schooling initially in Maharashtra, then in Mumbai, in the Mumbai part of Maharashtra, and then with the help of a grant from Maharaja Sayajirao Gaikwad of Baroda, he went to US in 1913, studied at Columbia University. He got his master's degree in 1915. He got his PhD degree in 1917. And then on, he went over the Atlantic to London. And there, he enrolled himself for Doctor of Science degree from London School of Economics and Political Science. So, in 1923, he got his Doctor of Science. All these were in economics. And while studying for Doctor of Science degree in London, he also registered himself to study law. And in 1922, he also became the barrister at law. They say that his commitment to study was so much that there were times when out of 24 hours a day, he used to study 21 hours a day. And when his roommates would tell him, why don't you take some rest? His answer used to be, no money, no food, no time, no sleep. Rarely, if ever, one can see the commitment to seek and achieve knowledge in so many different fields. The second aspect is economist. Third one is economic administrator, and I make a distinction between the two. Dr. Ambedkar was primarily, essentially an economist because all his degrees, excepting the degree of barrister at law, all other degrees are in economics. His MA was in economics, his PhD was in economics, his Doctor of Science was in economics. So all his major degrees are in economics. And in addition to that, he also studied law and became a barrister. The PhD dissertation that he wrote while at Columbia University, the title of that was The Evolution of Provincial Finances in British India. What he does there is to analyze over a long period, 1833 to 1921, he analyzes the center-state financial relationship, the relationship between the British central government and British central government and the provinces. They were not called state, they were called provinces of the British India. So the central state relationship, as the popular nomenclature now stands, he studied that, and that was his seminal contribution. After that, what is the relevance of that book today? I can tell you that as a constitution maker, he also made a provision for finance commission. Every 5 years, there is a finance commission appointed in India. What is the job of a finance commission? The job of finance commission is to decide, you know, when all the revenues and from the tax and non-tax revenues are collected by the central government, how much should the central government keep with itself? How much revenue should be given to the states? And what should be the broad principles for distribution of the booty, the tax and non-tax revenue to different states. In India, recently, the 15th Finance Commission has submitted its report. If you look at all the Finance Commission's report, 15 Finance Commission's report, the basic source of reference for all of these is Dr. Ambedkar's dissertation and book on provincial finance in the evolution of provincial finances in British India. So that is the relevance of this book. Then the next book on economics that he wrote 22 books actually, and only two of them major books are in economics. Others are on other subjects because, you know, he moved into so many different fields and so many different areas, disciplines. It is most remarkable. The second book that he wrote, which was for his doctor of science dissertation, is even more relevant. The title of the book is The Problem of Rupee, Its Origin and Its Solution. The problem of rupee, as everybody knows, continues even today. What he does in that book is very interesting. He talked about, not only he took a big, long overview, an analytical overview of how the Indian currency, the Indian rupee, has evolved over a period of time, for a long period of time, again, 1833 to 1920-21. After doing that, he talks about what is the most appropriate currency system for a developing country like India. Now, that discussion was very contemporary and very important even at that time. And that discussion is the timeless discussion. So he did that. And when he returned to India, as soon as he finished his education, he returned to India and was in social service from 1924. Very interesting thing happened in 1926. At that time, British government sent a commission called Hilton Young Commission to India. The job, the task entrusted to the commission was to formulate and outline a future establishment of a central bank for the country, that is the Reserve Bank of India. And this commission met lots of experts, but one of the most important statement that was made and evidence given before the committee in person was by Dr. Ambedkar. The report of the Hilton Young Commission, to which Dr. Ambedkar has contributed very important contribution, that became the focus and basis for 8 years later establishment of the Reserve Bank of India, which was established, which became operational on 1st April 1935. So in an indirect way, Dr. Ambedkar was instrumental in establishment of the Reserve Bank of India. Now, one of the things which he had said in his evidence and statement before the Hilton Young Commission was very, very important. He had said that this future Reserve Bank of India or the Central Bank of India that you are going to create, please make sure that it does not give too much credit to the government of India. The net credit extended by the Reserve Bank of India to the central government should be capped. We did not listen to him. The Reserve Bank of India was established 70 years later. When there was a major crisis in 1991, in 1993, finally there was an agreement between, and I used to work with the Reserve Bank of India then, and I was working on these issues. In 1993, there was an agreement between the government of India and the Reserve Bank of India, which basically limited the extent of the credit that the Reserve Bank of India would extend to the central government. Why should the Reserve Bank or Central Bank not extend a lot of credit to the government of India? Very simple. Dr. Ambedkar's argument was, if there is no control, and if the central government turns out to be irresponsible, then there would be too much credit would be given to the central government, and that would create inflation, because it would automatically, if there is a profligate government, then budget deficit or fiscal deficit would be financed by money created by the Reserve Bank of India, and that would create inflation. And he argued that inflation is the most iniquitous form of taxation because it hurts the poor the most. So this volume, this book, Monumental Contribution, is extremely important even today. One of the outside writing the books, he did a lot of things. But the most interesting one is that Dr. Ambedkar was he made a very important contribution in analyzing the economic dimensions of social maladies like the caste system in India. And I'm going to come back to this point, how the caste system influences and adversely affect the economic growth and prosperity of a country. He talked about that, and I'll come back to that when I talk about debate between Gandhiji and Dr. Ambedkar. Another thing that he did beyond writing the books on economics was very insightful participations in the Bombay Province Legislative Council as a nominated member in the beginning in 1926 and as an elected member of the assembly, the Bombay Provincial Assembly in 1937. And basically, in all his interventions, he would talk about first economics, the budgets of the state, and then he would talk about education and related areas. Then, even if you compare Indian constitution, Her Highness, Her Excellency was talking about the constitution of India. You know, the directive principles of state policy is a unique feature of the Indian constitution. And that is a creation of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Now, turning to the third aspect of the dimension of his personality, economic administrator. Dr. Ambedkar was not only a bookish economist. He was a very practical kind of economist. And as was mentioned, in 1942, he was taken on when Gandhiji called for Chale Jao, Quit India movement. At that time, the British response was to take some of the Indians into British cabinet in India. And Dr. Ambedkar was one of them. It was called Viceroy's Executive Council. And what were the ministries given to him? It's fascinating. He had labor and employment, central public works, energy, water management, and minerals. Today, there are 15 ministries which are covering these areas. And what are the contributions that he made? Number one, who started the employment exchanges in our country? Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Now there is so much talk about skill development, Skill India initiative. First ever skill development initiative was taken in public sector by Dr. Ambedkar. Then labor reform measures or labor welfare measures from reduction of work hours. For industrial labor, they used to be working 12 hours a day. It was cut down to 8 hours by Dr. Ambedkar. Then minimum wages, medical facilities for workers, health insurance, paid leave, even maternity leave for lady members who are workers was provided for. The beginning was made when Dr. Ambedkar was a member of British government's cabinet in India, 1942 to 1946. He also wrote the first water policy of India. He was the one who established Central Water Commission in India. Then Damodar Valley Project, Hirakund Dam in Odisha. All these are creations of Dr. Ambedkar when he was the minister. And establishment of the Central Electricity Authority. And finally, first ever policy on mineral resources was drafted by Dr. Ambedkar as a minister in the British cabinet. So he was not only a bookish economist, he was also a very practical, pragmatic, and a great economic administrator. I dare say that as an economist, I'm an economist by training. So as an economist, if I'm asked, who is the best ever economist that has been there in India's history, it would not be Professor Amartya Sen. It would not be Professor Abhijit Banerjee. These two great people have got Nobel Prize because Nobel Prize was established in 1969. That is 13 years after Dr. Ambedkar passed away. So in my view, the best ever economist that there was in the Indian history, it was none other than Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. The fourth aspect of his personality is social reformer. As was mentioned, the first social organization, he returned to India in November 23 with his advanced education. And immediately after that, he got to work. And in 1924, he established Bahishkruta Hitakarini Sabha. That was his first social organization. And what was the motto of that? The motto is very, very important and is used even now extensively. Educate, organize, and agitate. Educate, organize, and agitate. This was the motto, and it became the basic principle, basic objective, basic theme in the lives of millions of Indian people. In 1926, he was, after he was entered into public life, there were two satyagrahas he made, very, very important satyagrahas, that is mass movement. First was Mahad Satyagraha. In India, that time, there was, the untouchables did not have access to water. All the human beings of all the religion could go there and drink water. In fact, all the animals could also go and drink water. But untouchables were not allowed to drink water from the public reservoirs. So while there was a law already made opening the public reservoirs for people at large, it was never implemented. Dr. Ambedkar picked on that. And in a small town called Mahad in Maharashtra, he started his mass movement to exercise the civic right to water. And he did that. And that was the beginning of his mass movement. And simple right to access water was taken as a starting point. And he converted that into human rights issue over a period of time. Similarly, the second one, this was in 1927. In 1930, Dr. Ambedkar initiated the temple entry satyagraha, a mass movement to enter temples. And his argument was very simple. He said that, untouchables were not allowed into temples at all, although they were considered Hindus. He said, his argument was very simple, that you say that we are Hindus, then why should you have more rights than we do? Why can't we enter the temples? But on that, there was a huge controversy. Just like Mahad Satyagraha was embroiled in a huge controversy. But Dr. Ambedkar also said that getting into the temples is not going to make us immortal, nor are we going to die if we do not enter the temple. But it's a question of human right issue. It is, if you have an access to the temples, we are Hindus, we should also have access to temples. Otherwise, what good is this religion for us? This was his question. And in his mass movement, Dr. Ambedkar also organized a number of mouthpieces. First one was called Mooka Nayak, which means leader of the dumb, 1920. In 1927, Bahishkrut Bharat. In 1930, Janata. And at the end of his life, 1956, he started what was called the Prabuddha Bharat, Enlightened India. Just see the transition, even in the nomenclature, from silent India to enlightened India. That shows, and his exceptional proficiency, even in Marathi language. In English, of course, he excelled, but his proficiency on Marathi, my mother tongue and his mother tongue, is phenomenal, which is reflected in all these journals that he ran. But his strategy basically was for the first 10 years, for the first 10 years, Dr. Ambedkar fought it out while remaining within the confines of Hindu religion. You know, temple entry, satyagraha, or the Mahad water satyagraha, all these were within the framework of Hinduism. But after 10 years of working within the framework and trying to reform Hindu religion, he was frustrated. And in 1935, in a place called Yevla in Nashik, he made an announcement in Maharashtra. He said that, "I was a born untouchable Hindu, but I am not going to die as a Hindu." And that shook the country because he was talking about mass conversion into another religion. He did not rush into a new religion. For 21 years after that, he studied and he became an authority on comparative religion. And at the end of his life, merely 50 days before his Mahaparinirvan, he converted himself, he embraced Buddhism, and following him, 700,000 people accepted Buddhism. They embraced Buddhism. And my father and mother were two of those 700,000 people. Now, mass conversion is not uncommon in the world history, but this event was unique because wherever mass conversions have taken place in the world history, they have always been under duress, under the sword, under the pressure of the gun, or monetary incentive. Here was a unique and unprecedented occasion where 700,000 people renunciated their religion and embraced a new religion, Buddhism, on the word of their leader, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. That is what makes it unique. And why did he choose Buddhism? Just imagine what would have happened if, along with all his followers, if he had joined Islam. What would have happened if all of them had joined Sikhism? You know, the history of our country would have been different. Dr. Ambedkar wanted a religion which is born, which has emanated from the Indian soil, and the religion which is consistent with liberty, equality, fraternity, and social justice. That is why he chose Buddhism as a religion and got himself and his followers converted into that religion. Fifth aspect is education. Dr. Ambedkar was, as I mentioned before, you know, in his all interventions in the Bombay Legislative Council and Assembly, he always talked about education in addition to economics. But in 1945, he established educational institution of his own called People's Education Society. And they started running colleges, which are still there, Siddharth College in Mumbai and Milind College in Aurangabad. That is a backward region of Maharashtra now. It was part of the Nizam's princely state. Two things which are very interesting that he did. One was, in his college, there used to be a student parliament. So students would fight elections for different political parties, and there would be a parallel parliament form. This was, the idea was, and inaugurating that was always done by some huge parliamentarian. And the idea was to inculcate the democratic values and nuances into the minds of these young people. Another thing that he did as an educationist was to start morning colleges. Morning colleges started very early in the morning. That enabled a lot of people to improve their career, those who were working, so they could combine, earn and learn together using the morning classes. And two generations of all Indians in Mumbai and around got a huge benefit out of this because all colleges emulated that. Sixth aspect is the champion of annihilation of caste. Dr. Ambedkar was the most important champion of annihilation of caste in the 20th century. You know, in 1936, there was an organization called Jat Pat Todak Mandal in Lahore. Lahore was a part of India then. They invited Dr. Ambedkar as the chief guest to make a speech. And they also requested him that to send his draft. So Dr. Ambedkar was not well. Still, he took a lot of time to write a speech about eradication of the caste system. So he wrote that speech and showed the draft to them. And they were shocked because, you know, while they were doing Jat Pat Todak Mandal, they were doing marginal fixing here and there. This was a revolutionary approach in the speech because Dr. Ambedkar said that if you want to annihilate caste in India, then you have to apply dynamite to the Vedas and to the Shastra. Because the sanctity for caste system is coming from the religious holy books. So unless you destroy that, there is no way you can destroy the caste system. Now that was very difficult for the organizers to accept. So after a lot of discussion and hee-haw, finally the conference was canceled. And Dr. Ambedkar, the speech that he had written but not delivered, he published that as a book, which is one of his best books, most brilliant books, called Annihilation of Caste. After he wrote that book, immediate reaction came from Mahatma Gandhi himself. And Mahatma Gandhi wrote against that two articles in his own mouthpieces, criticizing Dr. Ambedkar's book. Dr. Ambedkar responded point by point to all of those, and both in the next edition, in a few months, he published Gandhiji's objections and his rebuttal side by side. For as a true democratic person, he put it open. One of the most important things that happened in that debate, I would like to highlight that, is that Mahatma Gandhi, contrary to general belief, was a big supporter of the caste system. Big supporter of the caste system. Not so small supporter, big supporter of the caste system, and he defended it. And he said that this is nothing but division of labor. And division of labor is a time-honored principle of economics. So what's wrong if we have a caste system? Caste system is necessary for social stability. This is what the argument was made, to which the rebuttal given by Dr. Ambedkar is an indication, you know, is a reflective of his razor-sharp intelligence. Dr. Ambedkar said that what we have, I don't need to be taught division of labor. I know about division of labor. But what we have in the caste system is not the division of labor. What we have is superimposed on the division of labor is division of laborers. Division of labor is natural, but division of laborers based on the accident of birth, not on talent. This is something which is very unnatural. And this has not happened in any part of the world at any time in the history. So to that, Dr. Ambedkar's rebuttal, Gandhiji had no answer to that. Dr. Ambedkar was also, and a lot of people, most people do not know, that he was a great anthropologist, social anthropologist. You know, as a student, he wrote a very interesting essay on caste. That was a time when he was 25 years old. But later, in his mature years, in 1946, he wrote a book called Who Are Shudras? You know, in India, there are four Varnas, Chatur Varna, as they call it, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra. So who were Shudras is one. And then there is another book in October 1948 that he wrote, Untouchables. Where were they? Who were they and why they became untouchables? Both of these are treatises are phenomenal, and they are seminal, and he has given new theories there, and he has challenged. If you see the preface, he says that, please prove that I'm wrong. Either you accept what I'm saying or prove that I'm wrong. But the system, you know, in the Indian system, his complaint was always that nobody would, from the so-called upper caste, stand up for the downtrodden. So there was nobody took cognizance of Dr. Ambedkar's major contribution to anthropology, and it still remains unchallenged but also ignored. The next aspect is Dr. Ambedkar's role as the first law minister of our country. As a law minister of our country, the first law minister of our country, there was a big debate about Hindu Code Bill. Hindu Code Bill was a major step in the direction of, you know, it was a major social reform, giving equal rights. Her Excellency, the ambassador, was talking about, as a woman, how she is grateful. I will tell you more, madam. Hindu Code Bill was a profound document that was intended to give equal rights to boys and girls in the property, in the Stridhan, and it allowed intercaste marriages. So it basically was a huge measure towards establishment of for gender equality. Major move that he made. Now, major move that he made, initially, our first Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, backed him up and said that no matter what, this is such a revolutionary bill that even if my government comes down, I don't care, but we are going to support this. We are going to stand by Dr. Ambedkar. Over a period of time, very strange thing happened. The orthodoxy of the Congress party and orthodoxy of the opposition, they got together, and they were led by the then President of India, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who said that this is going to destroy the family system in our country, which has been going on from the time immemorial. So we are going to oppose it. And President gave a threat also, in written threat, that if it comes to me for approval, for signature, I don't take it for granted that I'm going to sign it. So under the pressure, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru backed out and he dropped the whole idea. And so angry was Dr. Ambedkar that on the spot he resigned as a cabinet minister. Show me an example in Indian history where a cabinet minister had resigned on principles like this. So for gender equality, Dr. Ambedkar gave up his cabinet ministership. And in India, I was very happy when Madam Ambassador recognized his contribution to women at large. Generally, the women's organization in India do not recognize him as a messiah or as anybody who has done anything for them in the larger sense of the term. So that was his role as the first law minister of India. Ninth one is as a political leader. He was the most educated political leader that India had ever had. You know, he wrote 22 books in spite of his political turmoil that he lived through. He wrote 22 books on different subjects and many disciplines. In India, we never have had anybody coming even close to him. Dr. Ambedkar, you know, first time he gave a testimony was before South Boroughs Commission. South Boroughs Committee came in 1919. You know what was his demand? Madam, he demanded universal adult franchise in 1919, mind you. Even in America, the women got the right to vote in 1920. One year before that, in colonial India, Dr. Ambedkar had the vision to demand for universal adult franchise. That shows the man, the spirit of the man. Then, he testified before every commission. Then there was a major issue between him and Mahatma Gandhi, roundtable conferences. That was part of the constitutional reforms. First roundtable conference took place in 1931, which was not attended, which was boycotted by Congress Party. Second roundtable conference was attended by Congress Party. And it was led by a delegation led by Mahatma Gandhi himself. And Dr. Ambedkar attended all three. In the second roundtable conference, there was a big debate between Ambedkar and Gandhiji. And the issue was whether or not there should be independent electorates for untouchables for Dalits. Mahatma Gandhi's position was that no matter what, they will not get independent leadership, independent constituencies, separate electorates. They will not get. Ambedkar was focusing on getting separate electorates. So after a lot of cantankerous debate, and it is all part of the record, it's unbelievable the way they hit back at each other. But after a lot of cantankerous debate, they all decided that we should leave the decision to the British government. And all of them, including Mahatma Gandhi, gave in writing that whatever British government decide will be acceptable to us. Gandhiji was absolutely convinced that he's going to get his way. Regrettably and surprisingly for him, after a few months when the communal award, as the verdict was called, when communal award was announced, it went 100% in favor of Dr. Ambedkar and against Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi at that time was in jail in Pune, Yerwada jail in Pune. This was 1932. You know what he did? Immediately after that, he announced fast until death. Dr. Mahatma Gandhi fasted on many occasions, but fast unto death against one person was done, and that person was Dr. Ambedkar. So he went on fast unto death, saying that Ambedkar should withdraw his plea and he should accept what Mahatma Gandhi is saying, although he had given in writing that whatever British government decides would be acceptable to everybody. But he was a Mahatma, after all. So nobody could challenge that. And the contradiction, if an ordinary person does that, it would be laughed at. But it was Dr. Mahatma Gandhi. So their country was in turmoil and the life of Mahatma was in the hands of Dr. Ambedkar. So there was a lot of pressure. He was called traitor and what have you. Finally, under a lot of pressure, he gave in. And then there was an agreement between the two, Mahatma Gandhi and Dr. Ambedkar, that is called
Dr. Jadhav, you are muted. Dr. Jadhav, you're muted. Dr. Jadhav, your microphone is muted.
I have unmuted. Okay.
Yes.
All right. No. Are you okay? Okay.
Yes.
So intellectually speaking, I believe, and many others believe, that Dr. Ambedkar completely defeated Mahatma Gandhi intellectually. But in terms of political strategy, it was Mahatma Gandhi who defeated Dr. Ambedkar forever. Later on, it was Mahatma Gandhi who made him the chairman of the drafting committee of the constitution. Such was the greatness of Mahatma Gandhi also. But we'll come to that. So round table conference and then many movements as a politician he did many books that he wrote. Towards his first political party was called Independent Labour Party. Second political party was Scheduled Caste Federation. And third political party was Republican Party, which he established at the end of his life. The next role is the principal architect of the Indian Constitution. And we have spoken about this, but let me tell you the enormity of what he has done. Not only he was the chairman of the drafting committee of Constitution, that he was, and he worked very hard. And out of seven members of the committee, one of them never came for a single meeting. One of them was always abroad. One was very unwell. One of them died. So as one of the members has written, the almost entire responsibility of drafting fell on the shoulders of one person, that was Dr. Ambedkar. And he did a remarkable job, not only finalizing the draft, but piloting the draft in the Constituent Assembly. Remember, the Constituent Assembly had 295 plus, probably the most brilliant people in the country at that time, and they were talking about future of India. And Dr. Ambedkar was the one who piloted each of the provisions. So for each provision, he would talk about, discuss pros and cons, conduct the discussion, and finally strike a compromise and finalize it. Now, this required such acumen, such expertise, and such skills that, as Dr. Rajendra Prasad himself has recorded, nobody else could have done that. Single-handedly, Dr. Ambedkar piloted the whole constitution and got it through. And that is the beautiful constitution that we have. Recently, there was an article which said that, very interesting, that the average life of a constitution is 17 months. And in the 12 countries which became independent after the Second World War, of the 12 countries, only 3 countries have their constitution still going on as it is, in the sense with amendment, but it is going on. It has survived. And those 3 countries are India, South Korea, and Taiwan. All other countries, in Pakistan, there have been 4 constitutions so far. And there was a period when there was no constitution at all. But let's not go into that. The point is that a great constitution was given to India, and the principal architect, we are so stingy, we never called him principal architect of the Indian constitution. Never we called him. Who gave that title to him? No Indian leader gave him the title. This was given to him by the British biographer of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. And he called Dr. Ambedkar, principal architect of the Indian constitution and the field general of the campaign for a new constitution of India, unquote. Now, that also, many people, you know, can't accept that. You know, in the books and textbook, you'll find, you know, the stories of many other leaders. We know the obvious ones, Pandit Nehru and Mahatma Gandhi, in the skit and song and everywhere. But rarely, if ever, reference of Dr. Ambedkar comes. And even when it comes only as a marginal. And that too as a leader of untouchables. You know, very, very limited, confined. He was a nationalist to the core. In fact, it is his quote, "I'm Indian first and Indian at the last." That brings me to a very interesting aspect about linguistic reorganization of our country, of the states. In 1955, there was a report by Fazl Ali, which reorganized the states in India on the linguistic pattern. And they followed one simple rule. The rule was one language, one state, which looks very reasonable. One language, one state. Dr. Ambedkar said, no, this is completely wrong. It should be one state, one language. Now, what is the difference? One language, one state, and one state, one language. There is a major difference. He said that the dominance of Hindi is so much in the north that if you follow the principle, one language, one state, what will happen is this. In the north part of India, there would be fewer states which are large in size. And in south of India, there would be large number of states, but each one of them would be small one. And this would create a tension between north and the south. See the vision of the man. He said that Delhi should not alone be the capital. There should be a capital in the south. And at that time, he had pointed out Hyderabad could be a capital of the south. You know, alternate capital to Delhi. So there would be two capitals. This was a vision, not for Dalits, not for depressed classes. This was for people at large. And that is what he was, a true nationalist leader. But we have not recognized him well enough. The final dimension is a modern day champion of Buddhism. At one point of time, somewhere in the past, the whole country was Buddhist. Dr. Ambedkar turned the wheel around in full circle. That is why he is called Bauddha Dhamma, Bauddha Dharma, Bauddha Dhamma Chakra Pravartak. So he is the one who turned the wheel of Dhamma to bring it back in 360 degrees. So he did that by conversion on October 14, 1956, just 50 days before dying. And before his Mahaparinirvan, and he was the one who had he survived, probably the movement would have gone much further. But regrettably, he died within 50 days after that. But his book, the final book that he wrote, Buddha and His Dhamma, is his magnum opus. And that magnum opus was published posthumously, immediately after his death in 1957. He died on 6th December 1956, and the book was finally released in the first half of 1957. While looking at all this contribution, I want to conclude with this. He gave 537 speeches on Dr. Ambedkar. Dr. Ambedkar gave 537 speeches. To my mind, the best speech that he ever made was the speech when he presented the final draft of the Constitution to the Constituent Assembly. In that speech, he talks about future of democracy. He talks about, are we going to be able to maintain this democracy, not only in form, but also in fact. And he talks about history and he talks about future. It's the most remarkable speech, but the most important point that he made, the warning that he gave, I want to read that out to you. The warning that basically what he was saying is that what we have got now is political independence. That is necessary, but that is not sufficient. You have to move on from political independence to independence in social terms. Equality in social terms. Equality in economic terms. So political democracy must be converted into social democracy and economic democracy. Unless you do that, the political democracy itself may not survive. And his specific words are these. And I quote, this is the last part, end of my speech. I quote, on January 26, 1950, we are going to enter into a life of contradictions. In politics, we will have equality. And in social and economic life, we will have inequality. In politics, we will be recognizing the principle of one man, one vote, and one vote, one value. In our social and economic life, we shall, by the reason of our social and economic structure, continue to deny the principle of one man, one value. How long shall we continue to live this life of contradictions? How long shall we continue to deny equality in our social and economic life? If we continue to deny it for long, we will do so only by putting our political democracy in peril. We must remove this contradiction at the earliest possible moment, or else those who suffer from inequality will blow up the structure of political democracy which this assembly has so laboriously built up, unquote. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jadhav, for your brilliant exposition and such an informative lecture. I'm sure all the participants from Korea as well as India must have gained a lot. We have a couple of questions in the chat box. I also request the participants to raise their virtual hand from the participant window so that we may call you for a live interaction. Meanwhile, being the moderator, let me take the privilege of asking the very first question. My very first question to you, Dr. Jadhav, begin from where you have just ended, how Dr. Ambedkar talked about the future of democracy, and he talked about not only the future of democracy in form, but also in fact, and how he focused on political independence and how it should be also go well in coordination with social as well as economic democracy. So given these facts and his ideals of achieving a social and economic democracy in India. Dr. Jadhav, how do you see the present situation in India? What would have been his response to the present crisis that we have, especially in the context of the global pandemic and the challenges that we are facing today in the social field, as well as in the economic field, particularly the economic the turmoil that we feel that we face not only in India but in the entire world in the economic field, as well as the challenges that our migrant laborers and other marginalized communities are facing during this time of global pandemic. Dr. Jadhav, your response on this.
All right. I'm going to write down all the questions and I will answer it one go, if you don't mind.
Okay.
This is a very, very good question and I'm going to give you an honest answer.
Yeah. Meanwhile, there are a couple of questions in the chat box. I have just collected them. One of our students is asking a question on the conflict between Gandhi and Ambedkar. If you could highlight on that. The second one is on the participant wants you to elaborate on Poona Pact as well as the Hindu Code Bill. And the third question from Dr. Santosh is that RBI and successive governments ignored his contribution and didn't give him due respect and recognition, like publishing his image on Indian currency. Do you think it was because...
I'm sorry. I did not hear the... after the Hindu Code Bill, I did not hear.
Yeah. This question, the last question is that RBI and the successive governments ignored his contribution and did not give him due respect and recognition, like publishing and recognizing or putting his image on Indian currency. Do you think it was because of his caste background? Meanwhile, we have two hands also raised. May I request Dr. Priya, to ask your question?
Yeah, thank you so much, Sonu. Thank you so much, Dr. Trivedi. Thank you so much, Dr. Jadhav. I really enjoyed listening to you and it was a terrific lecture. So thank you for that. I had a question about what you ended with, about what Dr. Ambedkar said about social rights and political rights. And historians of the Constitutional Assembly, they often say that it's a mystery as to how Dr. Ambedkar eventually agreed to political rights being justiciable under the fundamental rights and social rights being non-justiciable. So I'd just like to know of your insights about that and why do you think that took place? Because it was a huge compromise, a huge personal compromise that he made. So yes, I'd like your views on that, please. Thank you.
And may I invite Mr. Ganesh to ask a direct question? Mr. Ganesh, if you're there. Dr. Sanjeev?
Yes, now I got the permission to unmute from your end. So can I come in?
Yes, please.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all of you and Narendra Jadhav sir. It is like...
Can you switch on your video, please?
No, I'm not in the like...
Carry on.
So after a long time, I'm seeing him. As a VC of Pune University, his regime, I'm saying regime, not as a VC, but regime, because he is the one who had handled so many challenges in the state of Maharashtra. Being VC and being political analyzer, I can say, or economist, or Maharashtra state as development planning and all. What I'm saying, or what my point is, sir, that see, Maharashtra state is altogether different from other states. One, why I'm saying, from education or educational institutional background, that other state like Haryana, Punjab, Rajasthan, UP, Bihar, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, all these states have public service commission through which the lectureship post is being filled or appointment is going through that process. But Maharashtra doesn't have. Maximum institutions in Maharashtra are owned by either some of the political parties, political leader, MLA or MP, and they will ask huge money to recruit for the post of assistant professor in any subject, may it be art, science, commerce, whichever discipline it could be. And you are the one, what I'm saying is, post-independent or after Baba Saheb Ambedkar, you are the one, Sukhdev Thorat sir, Professor Sukhdev Thorat sir is second, and Bhalchandra Mungekar sir is the third. These were the people to whom we were watching or to whom we were adoring much towards their educational step or planning steps. But as of now, we did not see anything because everything is in Maharashtra power lobby. I am last 2 years, I am searching the job. From whichever background I am coming, I am not able to pay a single penny to any institution. So why did not you take the stance that you can be or you may be able to take for
Could we move to Dr. Sanjeev? Dr. Sanjeev, please switch on your video and ask your question. Dr. Sanjeev, are you here? Mr. Vishal?
Yeah, can you hear me, Sonu?
Yes, please.
Sorry. Mm-hmm. There was some trouble at my end. Professor Jalab, in fact, it was a very fascinating presentation. In fact, the way you brought the multifaceted dynamics of Dr. Ambedkar to all of us, I think it's deeply appreciated. I really have a question in the context of how you brought Gandhi into the discourse while referring to Ambedkar and the Gandhi debate that was there during the pre-independent era. My question precisely has come to you to get a sense of what is your idea about the caste. Of course, when you look at the work of Ambedkar, he in fact was more radical in his approach to the whole idea of the caste system. But to say that Gandhi was a strong defender of the caste system, I think that is where I would beg to agree with you. If you look at the life of Gandhi and the way he handled the issue of caste and the complex issue of caste in terms of the dynamics of the Indian politics and the way the whole issue of untouchability was addressed by Gandhi, I think this will be a strong statement to make to argue that Gandhi was a strong defender of the caste system. Of course, he was not as much radical as Ambedkar to suggest burning Manusmriti as you have suggested, but as you know, his ideas on the caste evolved consistently as he went through his take on the issues of caste. So right from 20s to the 40s, you see there is a consistent effort of Gandhi in terms of addressing the question of caste. So I think it would be more fair to say that Gandhi's position on caste was more evolutionary, of course not as radical as Ambedkar, as you have rightly suggested. Thank you, sir.
Okay, got it. Very good. Excellent.
And maybe we can take, sir, one more question. Mr. Vishal? Mr. Vishal?
Hello. Yes. Hello, ma'am. Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I want to ask about this. So please explain conflicts between Mahatma Gandhi and Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and their ideologies and their viewpoints about patriotism.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
About patriotism?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, you can answer these questions.
All right. Okay. I will start answering. Shall I start from the reverse? Gandhi Ambedkar conflict, a lot of people have asked. Second question was Gandhi Ambedkar conflict. And ninth question was, final question was also on conflict between Gandhiji and Ambedkar. I will tell you a secret. I'm writing a book on this subject, Gandhi versus Ambedkar, and it should be out in next 3 or 4 months when the lockdown is relaxed. This is a huge subject and there is a lot of confusion and very strong feeling that we saw Dr. Sanjeev also expressing this feeling. But as far as the patriotism is concerned, both of them, you know, you cannot say that Ambedkar was not patriot. Of course, Mahatma Gandhi was the super patriot and there is just no doubt about it. Their relationship is a love-hate relationship. Let me talk about their first meeting. Their first meeting took place, you know, after the first roundtable conference, which was not attended by Mahatma Gandhi or anybody from Congress, but Dr. Ambedkar made many speeches there. So after making many speeches, Dr. Ambedkar, his name was known. And then Mahatma Gandhi called him for a meeting. Just when he was on the verge of leaving for attending the second conference. I think it was September 1931 or something like that. Now what happens is Mahatma Gandhi writes him a postcard saying that I want to meet you. Tell me whether I should come to meet you or you will come to meet me. Now Gandhiji was 22 years older than Dr. Ambedkar. So there was no question of Ambedkar saying that you come to me. And Gandhiji was already a national leader. Ambedkar was a promising upstart, firebrand, but promising upstart. So Gandhiji was told, Ambedkar said, no, I'm coming to you. So the meeting took place in Mumbai in a place called Mani Bhavan, which is still there at the museum. In Mani Bhavan, so when Ambedkar went at the pre-assigned time, Gandhiji was a politician also. Let's not forget that. Cent, half cent, Ambedkar called him half cent and half politician. So what he did was to make Ambedkar wait for quite some time. And he was talking to some foreign journalists. And he was showing them how to spin the wheel and so on. So nothing cataclysmic was happening. So Ambedkar was seething with anger. So just before he was about to explode when Ambedkar was called inside. So Gandhiji said, Dr. Ambedkar, I hear that you have been speaking against me and you have been writing against me. I want to tell you, Bapuji said, that I have been working for untouchables from the time when you were not even born. This will make Sanjeev very happy, Dr. Sanjeev very happy. But the answer will make him very unhappy. Because Gandhiji's Ambedkar said, all old people make a point of their age when they have nothing else to say. So Gandhiji was taken aback. Then Gandhiji changed his track, the great politician that he was. So Gandhiji said that, look here, you should check. Recently, I told Jawahar, meaning Jawaharlal Nehru, and to collect 20 lakh rupees for spending for, upliftment of the untouchables. 20 lakh rupees, and that was a lot of money at that time. So Ambedkar's response was, Bapuji, this is not needed. You don't have to spend 20 lakh rupees. All this money is going to go west. You have to do very simple thing, which does not cost you any money. You make a condition. You are ruling Congress Party now. So you make a condition that every Charana member, that is the general membership, was quarter of rupees. One quarter of a rupee, that is Charana. So they used to be called, general members of Congress were called Charana members. So every Charana member of Congress Party takes an oath that he or she will not practice untouchability in their homes, in their personal life, one. And second, they should keep, hire, recruit, invite at least one touchable in 1 week to either work with them or to dine with them. You don't have to spend any money. Now, see the difference, the fundamentalism and, something very superficial. My point, and I have demonstrated that amply, and Gandhiji and Ambedkar himself has written extensively about it. In 1948, Dr. Ambedkar wrote a big book called What Congress and Gandhi Have Done to Untouchables. You should see how he has pieced it together step by step to show how orthodox Gandhiji was and how defender of the caste system he was. Let me just tell you one thing. I have written a whole book on that. Do you know that? Now, this is unbelievable. Everybody that I have shown this, they say it is not true. It can't be true. But there is a documentation. I can't write without documentation. Do you know that Gandhiji believed so much in ancestral calling? He called it ancestral calling, okay? That everybody must do the job that is done by his father. or mother, what is the family tradition? That is what everybody must do. Now, this looks all right, but not so. He actually is on record that a person who is carrying excreta on his head, you know, the community that cleans the toilets, his son must do the same work. Even there is a complete freedom for him to educate himself. He can be a doctor, engineer, anything, but he has to do his ancestral calling. Can you imagine Mahatma Gandhi has actually said this? That a person coming from that particular community, no matter how much is his education, he must do this menial, horrible task, irrespective of his proven mettle, proven talent. What do you call this, if not a defender of the caste system? Dr. Ambedkar was a revolutionary, yes, but Dr. Gandhiji's evolution was so slow. He was very kind-hearted. And when untouchability was abolished in the Constituent Assembly, when they passed that, people all said, shouted that Mahatma Gandhi ki jai. Mahatma Gandhi was the greatest leader of the Indian freedom struggle. And I have no doubt in my mind about that. But if you tell me that he was also eradicator of the caste system in India, I will say zero. Absolutely not. For the details, you wait for my book. But in the meantime, try to take a look at the book, What Congress and Gandhi Have Done to Untouchables by Dr. Ambedkar himself. In that meeting when they fought, Gandhiji said, Dr. Ambedkar told Mahatma Gandhi that, Bapuji, I have no homeland. So he said, no. Why do you say that? You know, from all the reports that I have got, I know you are patriot of sterling order. These are his words. You know, it went on. But finally, when they parted company in that same meeting, you know, what were the parting words of Dr. Ambedkar? He said that Mahatma, that I'm quoting his exact words, we don't believe in Mahatmas. Mahatmas are like fleeting phantoms. They only raise the dust and not the level. Nobody had guts to say that to a person like Mahatma Gandhi, who was such a huge person in the national scheme of things. Ambedkar did. And, you know, a lot of things happened between them. But on the contrary, I would also tell you that Ambedkar got a chance to become member of the Constituent Assembly. They had decided to, you know, fix Ambedkar. And when Ambedkar could never win a Lok Sabha election, do you know that? First time he contested was 1952 from Mumbai, he was defeated. 1954, he contested a by-election from a small place in northeast of Maharashtra called Bhandara. And there, Congress put out a candidate against him who was fifth standard fail and got him elected to show that all your degrees and all your erudite scholarship doesn't matter. We have the brute majority and we are not going to get you elected. So Ambedkar was never elected to Lok Sabha. He was part of Rajya Sabha. But Congress had also decided to defeat him and not let him enter the Constituent Assembly. But Ambedkar was also an astute politician. He went to West Bengal that time, and got elected from Bengal with the help of Jogendranath Mandal. He got elected from Bengal. That's how he came to the Constituent Assembly. And in Constituent Assembly, he changed his strategy. And first time he spoke, you know, they were all ready to thump him down, you know, whittle it down. But he made such a brilliant speech that before they realized, they started, you know, thumping the desk. And the brilliant speech that he made, that was the time when Gandhiji's mind also changed. And I give entire credit to only one person, Mahatma Gandhi, who made him cabinet minister in India's first cabinet. It was Mahatma Gandhi who made him chairman of the drafting committee of the constitution. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru never wanted him. As the story goes, now this one is not confirmed, but I believe the story goes that Jawaharlal Nehru went with a list of candidates. That time Mahatma Gandhi was a remote control. Every decision had to be approved by him, major decision. So Jawaharlal ji goes with a list. So he saw the list. First question he asked Jawaharlal Nehru was this: where is Baba Sahib Ambedkar? Jawaharlal Nehru could not believe his eyes because they were fighting like cats and dogs. So he went out and scribbled the name of Dr. Ambedkar. That's how Ambedkar came into the cabinet. Second time, Jawaharlal Nehru went to Mahatma Gandhi to say that these are the names, and he wanted to propose. He proposed a British man to head the Constitution Committee, you know, a drafting committee. To which Gandhi ji said, "Tumhe hamare desh mein koi aisa vyakti nahi dikhai deta hai." Dr. Ambedkar ji ke baare mein aapki kya hai? Meekly, Pandit Nehru had to withdraw and make that addition. So I give 100% credit to Mahatma Gandhi for A, making Dr. Ambedkar a cabinet minister after India became independent, and also credit for his given the role of the drafting committee chairman for the constitution. Of course, he turned it out into a golden opportunity. That is a different thing. But the opportunity was given by Mahatma Gandhi. So both of these great people, they had love-hate relationship. But both of them, I think they knew with their heart of heart that the country is bigger than them. So no matter how much they fought with each other, ultimately what they both thought was good for the country, they did. And that is what is the story of their patriotism. Coming to other questions, you know, Dr. Sonu asked a question about present situation in India, particularly in the context of the global pandemic, etc. Well, I'm not going to give you official answer, but I can, as an economist, I'm going to give you answer. You know, we have made a remarkable comeback in terms of economic growth. You know, we have achieved what is called V-shaped growth, V-shaped recovery. So there was a sharp going down and there is a sharp coming up. Now for the year 21-22, for the coming year, financial year, India's growth rate is expected to be in the range of 11-12% after fall of about 7%. So this is a great achievement. But combine this with something else that is called K-shaped recovery. You know, some experts are saying that this is, yes, V-shaped recovery, but another way to look at it is a K-shaped recovery. Why K-shaped recovery? K-shaped recovery in the sense that the stock market is scaling new heights when the economy is going down. Those who are working from home, they are doing much better. Whereas those who are working with their hands, they are going down. They are losing their jobs and they are losing their incomes. Those who are in the organized sector, those are doing very well. And those who are in the SMEs or MSMEs, they are doing badly and they are being closed down every day in many parts of the country. So this is also a V-shaped recovery, which is admirable, but also a K-shaped recovery, which is not so admirable. This is going to increase the income inequalities in our country. And government is doing every which way they are trying to bridge this gap and make sure that the growth that takes place is more inclusive. That is why we had a series of 5 packages and we had a wonderful budget that was presented recently. But the fact is that with the V-shaped recovery, there is also a K-shaped recovery, which is shaking us up. Coming to Pune Pact. Pune Pact was signed in you know, the basic issue was that whether or not to have independent electorates. And Gandhiji said no. And Ambedkar said that this is what we want. And as I said, after a lot of debate, it was decided that the British government will take a final decision. And Gandhiji wrote a letter reminding, do you know that? It is documented. Gandhiji wrote a letter to the Viceroy and to the Secretary of State for India saying that I want you to recall that I have said in the second roundtable conference in my final speech that if you give independent electorates, I will take drastic action and I will not let that happen at any cost. This is what I had said. So he reminded, this was nothing but a threat that if you go that way, you are going to face a problem and I'm going to go on some, I'll take some strong action. That is, but that letter also did not cut any ice. So British government, for whatever reasons that they had, they opted for Ambedkar. So in response, outraged Mahatma. By the way, Dr. Ambedkar never called Mahatma Gandhi as a Mahatma after that particular point of time, after their debate in 1930-31 in the second roundtable conference. But when Ambedkar started his movement, it's very interesting. When Ambedkar started his movement, Mahar Satyagraha, there was only one image in the procession, and that image was Mahatma Gandhi's image. Do you know that? So you were asked later, now you are opposing Gandhiji so much. Why did you do that at that time? So he said, Gandhiji is the only politician who has talked about the social issues. No other politician has been talking about it. So, you know, it goes both ways and one has to look at it both ways. As far as the Hindu Code Bill is concerned, I don't know what you want to know, but it basically was giving equal rights to men and women. It was a major step in gender equality. It was a major step in terms of allowing not marriage which are sanctimonious marriage, but marriage which is intercaste. Now, intercaste marriage has become so common now. In fact, in 10 years, all that Ambedkar was saying actually became law. But at that time, the atmosphere created was such that everybody got together and opposed it. The orthodoxy of Congress and orthodoxy of the opposition. And they shot it down, and that's why Dr. Ambedkar resigned. In his resignation, later, he has given one of the major reasons why I'm resigning is my inability to get through such a revolutionary reform. So he did that in the interest of, there are political reasons also, but he did that in the interest of women and gender equality. RBI ignoring contribution of Dr. Ambedkar. You know, we don't have much time. We are already late. But whether his image should be on Indian currency. I have given this proposal to the Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi in when there was this committee to celebrate the 125th birth anniversary of Dr. Ambedkar. So exactly 5 years back. At that time, Modiji had formed the National Committee, not a very big committee, but committee of independent persons and some politicians. It was a combination. That time I was not in politics at all. And in that committee, it is on record that I made a suggestion that this is an easy thing to do and that must be done. And I said that along with Dr. Ambedkar, you can put some other names also if you like. And I give examples that in US, there are 20 presidents which are on the currency bills of different denominations now and in the past. Same thing in Britain. There are 16 of them in the currency now and in the past. So why are we having only one person? This is not to undermine the greatness and the contribution of the father of the nation. No, nobody is saying that. But then there are other contributors. They should also be reflected in currencies. And Dr. Ambedkar should be a prime candidate. So that suggestion has already been made by me, and some other people have also been talking about. There was a very tough question asked, and this was about by Dr. Priya, about certain provisions becoming justiciable and some provisions becoming non-justiciable. Particularly, what stands out is the directive principles of state policy, which has been made non-justiciable. In other words, now I'm not a student of law, but I know this much, that by making it non-justiciable, it meant that if the government does not follow that strictly, then you can't hold the government to task. You cannot sue the government if they do not do that. So this was the particularly the directive principles of state policy. There was a big demand that it should be made justiciable. But then the compromise was made. I do not know the inside story of why that happened. But yes, Ambedkar agreed that it would be non-justiciable because there was on the positive side, a provision cannot, you can't force a government to do that with the limited resources, and you know, it has to be. Okay. So within the constraints of the policy resources, policy could be adopted. Best example is the right to education. Right to education was there in the directive principles of state policy from 1950. How long did we take to implement that? 2010. Even today, 11 years after implementation, the implementation has been very poor, either poor or very poor. That is how we have treated the directive principles of state policy. So I agree with you that they could have been justiciable. Had they been justiciable, governments could have been held responsible, but the governments get the benefit of doubt because they are non-justiciable. But how did that happen and how did Ambedkar agree to that? There were many things in the constitution that Dr. Ambedkar had to agree against his will because it was a collective effort, and final important thing was to have the constitution in the best possible form. So this must be one of those compromises that were made. There was a question asked by Sanjeev, but that is the more on a personal side about my being VC and about what is happening in Maharashtra. Maharashtra has the MPSC, Maharashtra Public Service Commission. Yes, I have heard stories about the corruption in appointments, but this is not the time, nor forum, or the person to talk to about it. But I share your concern completely. I thank all of you for asking very, very good questions. And I may or may not have answered all your questions, but you can be rest assured that questions, if they still remain in your mind, will try to find answers and you will find them. And look for my book on Gandhi versus Shankar. That should be coming out in the next 3 or 4 months or little more. So you will get a lot of what I have to say on the conflict, because this is a beautiful period of conflict and compromise between the two great leaders of our country, those who shaped modern India. Dr. Mahatma Gandhi, in my opinion, Mahatma Gandhi was fully responsible for the freedom struggle and political independence or creation of political democracy. But it was Dr. Ambedkar who made a republic which is based on liberty, equality, fraternity, and social justice. In that way, it is Dr. Ambedkar who, while the political conscience of the country was Mahatma Gandhi, I would imagine that the social conscience of our country is Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar. I thank you all. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jadhav, for being so generous with time and taking up all the questions. I'm afraid we'll not be able to take any more questions. We have already exceeded the time limit. I would now right away request Ms. Savita Singh to give the concluding remarks. Over to you, Savita.
Very briefly, though it has been a very, very engaging session, my colleague, Dr. Sonu, started the session with very, very nice introduction to Baba Sahab's life. And then Her Excellency, Dr. Ranganathan, has touched various significant facets of his contribution to not only India, but towards the world. And coming to today's special lecture, sir, I personally feel that this lecture has been, like a book, reading a book. You have summarized, you have elaborated also very unique facets of his life, and you have summarized them very beautifully in a dozen of points. I think each point was elaborated well, and it seems that you have written different books on each facet. What I personally feel that we, all the women, as ma'am has also said in the beginning, that we personally feel grateful. And I, as a woman with the total visual impairment, feel proud to be a citizen of the country where Baba Sahab has not only written, not only framed the entire constitution, but he has given us a vision that we should today, as a tribute to his life, should pick up. And if each one of us can make a promise to ourselves that we will do our bit, then maybe to some extent, we can overcome the warning Baba Sahab has given in his memorable speech, which sir has referred in his speech. So I will not take much of your time. I would request Sonu to organize more such lectures, more such events where we can have more interaction with sir. And certainly we can grab his books and enrich ourselves, our understanding. So on behalf of this Vivekanand Center for Cultural Studies, as well as on behalf of Zakir Hussain Delhi College, University of Delhi, I would like to present a vote of thanks to you, sir. Thank you for sparing time and giving this informative lecture. It has been a wonderful session, and I'm sure all the students are feeling as I am feeling after the session. There will be more questions. We will maybe we can send the chat box. We can share the chat box with you later.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. And I would like to express gratitude to Her Excellency, Madam Ranganathan, for her valuable time. I'm grateful to all the participants and my colleagues for their valuable time and for participating in this event. To all the students for their questions, for their enthusiastic participation. And last but very, very important, I'm grateful to the technical team for providing smooth support to this event. So over to you, Sonu.
Thank you, Savita. Thank you. Thank you for your concluding remarks and also proposing a vote of thanks. And let me in the end, again, once again, thank the entire team and Dr. Jadhav for your brilliant lecture, so much of information, a power-packed lecture, I must say. And I'm sure our Korean friends also here must have gained a lot. And we see some of your fans here with books and placards. Can I request my team member to spotlight with the name iPad 3? Yeah. We saw both your books. Could you please show the book?
Yeah, that's the Korean version. Some of your fans
are sitting here live, though the language is a problem.
This is the children's edition. Korea is the only one where there's a children's edition published. Oh, wonderful, wonderful.
Let's have this a great round of applause.
This is my dear friend who made a beautiful portrait of mine only last month. Thank you, Mr. O. I'm glad you could make it. Okay, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, all right.
Thank you, Dr. Jadhav, and all the participants. Many, many thanks for joining. Thank you, sir.